Okay, let's get back. So basically, you know, as I said, different countries are in different stages of development and different per capita income levels, etc. So how should these economies approach to achieve? What is the path to take to achieve economic development? So we just are going to give a very brief comparison, not in terms of the success or failure of those approaches or the pathways, which is often done in mainstream economic theories, mainstream economic textbooks, they do all these comparisons, but in terms of how environmentally benign these approaches are, how this needs to be done, etc., is what I have. So after that, we will have some discussion. If there is any clarification, etc., you can always raise your hand. So now, the basic question that we are asking here, so from now on, actually, we just want to put it, pose it in the form of a question and then say whether we are able to find an answer. It's not necessary that once I pose a question that I will have an answer to all these questions. Sometimes I may not really have answers to these questions. So the basic question that we are asking is, are there any systematic association between the environmental conditions and the kind of development pathways or strategies that countries have followed? Is environment so bad in US today because of the kind of development strategy that they adopted? Energy consumption, they are struggling to reduce because late 19th century, their model is basically in terms of personalized transport system, not public transport system. Obviously, the energy consumption is very high in such situation. So they are unable to change the people's mindset to switch over to public transport system. One of the major concerns, for example, for them. We switched over to personal transport system only out of the infrastructure constraints and poor quality of public transport, etc. And even if you want now, it's not easy for us to switch over to public transport system, for instance. So one example is the whether you go for public transport system or personalized transport system. Japan has completely switched over to public transport system, excepting in the case of few top officials, because it's so difficult to drive the vehicle in the road because of traffic jams and delays and all that. The first question is whether there's a systematic relationship. Answer being, there are reasons to expect that there might be, in view of the fact that development strategy influences variables, which in turn influence environmental conditions. How do they do that? So that's what we try to communicate here. What does the development strategy do? Whether development strategy of this particular government, previous government, or across countries in the world. Everywhere, development strategy is the roadmap for achieving your economic development. It tries to alter the structure of domestic production. Service sector, manufacturing sector, agriculture, shares are changing, growth rates are different. So therefore, structure of domestic production, it alters. When you give more emphasis for construction, construction takes the lead. Transportation, they take the lead. It alters the structure of domestic production. Secondly, the nature of the binding constraints facing the economy. That is what you're trying to do. What are the binding constraints? Financial constraint. People are not able to access credit. So remove all the hurdles. Make it as simple as possible. Binding constraint. In spite of following public distribution system of food grains for 60 years, still there are starvation deaths. People are not able to receive the food subsidy. And of every 100 rupees spent by the government, only 16 rupees value of it reaches the most needy people. Studies have shown. So government is now wondering, should we continue to have this public distribution system of Food Corporation of India procuring grains from farmers, distributing through the ration shops and others? Or should we simply do a money transfer, cash transfer, to the bank account of all the poor people so that they can buy from whichever shop they want? It will reduce the spillage. Is lost in transit can be plucked by direct transfer of money to them. But then people who argue against it are saying, so that means there's change. Nature of binding constraint, the constraint is changing. Now you have direct money in your bank account. You can use it. But then people say, what is the guarantee they will spend it only on pulses and rice and wheat and not on alcohol? And whose account should we transfer? To the lady head of the house or to the male head of the house? So there's no guarantee if you give it to the male head, it'll reach the family. All those issues will come up. Of course, so, but it will take care of one constraint, but not cannot be a foolproof system. But at least nature of the most binding constraint, it gets altered. I'm just giving an example of this variety. Thirdly, technological and investment choices also change when the development strategy influences technological changes. We are switching over, say for example, ICT, massive investment in ICT has enabled all of us to be connected wherever we are. It is because of ICT that we are going to be able to reach out the length and breadth of the country through this course. What do you visual? If not for ICT, how can it be possible? In a typical QIP or CEP program that we conduct, maximum we get is 30 candidates in a particular. So how many times can we have to repeat ourselves? And how much does it cost when compared to this sort of mode? The institutional structure, new kinds of institutional structure, now we are talking more in terms of indirect regulations rather than direct regulations. Several you only have a regulatory role. It also affects the income distribution and domestic to international prices, which is what is called terms of trade. All that development strategy does. That is typical economic impact. Now, since these variables affect energy consumption, at least two examples I thought I'll put it here, energy consumption and the pattern of land use in agriculture, it will have impact on the environment. Only because of two factors, two intermediate factors. Development strategy won't achieve impact earlier factors that you discussed earlier. Now, because of them, the two intermediate steps, energy consumption and pattern of land use, both changes for a variety of reasons. And therefore, it can lead to environmental degradation. Let me give you some examples of cases here. Let's look at developing countries. Somebody asked me this question on which sector is using more and more energy. So if you look at environmental damage in developing countries, it can be discussed in terms of four factors. They are air and atmospheric pollution, water pollution and depletion, land degradation, soil erosion, desertification, and fourthly, deforestation. Let's look at each one of them, air and atmospheric pollution. As you all know, energy generation and utilization emit hydrocarbon, nitrogen oxide, sulfur dioxide, and ozone into the layer. And places where energy producing and energy consuming activities are concentrated, the concentration of these pollutions are high. That you already know. Now, in the specific context of developing countries, air pollution is aggravated by the use of energy inefficient technology with no pollution control and by the use of cheaper, high sulfur content, low quality coal and fuel oil, especially for heating and transport. Now, look at this. One of the WHO studies have shown of the 12 cities worst population in the world, only two are in developed countries. Rest 10 are in developing countries. Okay, so even on good days, Beijing, Tehran, Rio have mean daily concentrations of SO2 much above 2.5 times the WHO standard. Recent research has shown, published in Economic and Political Weekly, that if air quality in Delhi improves, that the longevity of people living in Delhi will also increase. And they've done a lot of exercise on that. Now, so what is the problem? Problem in developed countries, cities are improving. Those are developing countries are deteriorating. Largely because of unplanned urbanization, pressure of development, and urban concentration. Right now, there's another workshop going on organized by my colleagues right in this building on sustainable urbanization. That's one of the major issues here. But what about rural? Rural air pollution is also very high. Particulates, organic matters, and various oxides result seasonally from burning grasslands and front forest clearing for, you know, cultivation and grazing. Most common in sub-Saharan Africa especially. And indoor concentration of carbon monoxide, particulates and hydrogen is also because of poor ventilation. Now, this is the table I was referring to, the gentleman who asked me this question. The percentage of sector-wise commercial energy use. The developed and the newly industrialized, NIC are newly industrializing countries. Okay, together I have where 40% is for industry, commercial and residential use is 30%, 20% for transportation. But look at the poorest developing country. Look at this. Their commercial energy use is concentrated more and more on transportation, not on industry, which can get them development. That is the worry. Energy consumption is high, emission is high, but development is also not taking place. That's where the worry is, especially in poorest developing countries. When you talk about poorest developing country, we are not included in that. See, that's why I always say, when we give a comparative perspective, please always remember, you don't have to feel complacent that you're doing better than Somalia and Ethiopia, but it's also important that you compare yourself with what they are doing also. Last week, I attended a conference on India and the Indian Ocean, a theme, because India wants to be a leader in for all the countries in the Indian Ocean. I thought, who are all going to be there? Representatives from as far away Africa till Indonesia. All countries in the Indian Ocean got represented. They are looking forward to India as a leader for them. And they want India to play a major role for technology transfer for them in various sectors. We cannot undermine, we cannot say, no, we refuse to play a role, etc. here. Now, when it comes to industry, also in many of these countries, it is the composition of industrial output. Most polluting industries. Now, economic survey gives the data on how many units are closed in most polluting industries, how many units are concentrating in most polluting industries. Again, uneven. In most of these industries, energy accounts for half of their total intermediate cost. And uneven use of energy across sector, which makes it main link between development strategy and the energy consumption. That is the problem that we are facing, uneven mix of use of energy access across sectors. Coming to water, two major water related are contamination and depletion. Surface and groundwater are being contaminated by agriculture, industrial, urban and human waste. Safe drinking water is a major problem, apart from sanitation. Between 25 and 75% of rural population in different developing countries do not have access to safe drinking water. And the results are several kinds of infections and shortened life expectancy. Now, what happens in developing countries is nearly 73% of water is used in irrigation. And still the productivity is low when compared to developed countries. And it's also developing countries account for 75% of the world's irrigated land area. But they require twice as much water as per acre as do the developed countries. Because of several other constraints, absence of economies of scale in cultivation and all that. But that's because you want to have, give them access to, you want to have subdivision, fragmentation of landholding and several others. Because of your political compulsion, social compulsion. So how do we bring in? Another problem is land degradation, soil erosion, desertification. Cultivable land is the basis of livelihood for 80% of the population in many countries. Extremely rapid population growth, unsound agriculture practices, and thereby land erosion and desertification, etc. What is the magnitude of the problem? Again, soil erosion through the loss of topsoil, either washed away or blown off the land. Estimates of the extent of desertification also vary substantially. According to United Nations Environmental Program, 2/5 of Africa's non-desert areas, 1/3 of Asia's and 1/5 of Latin America are at the risk of desertification. So something urgently need to be done in these places. Who is affected the most? The world's poor are the most seriously affected, since they depend on the marginal lands for their livelihood. They depend on this for livelihood. Population pressure, agriculture practice, poverty, price policy, and economic institutions interact to produce the devastating effect in mutually reinforcing cycle. How does it work? Let me give you a typology scheme, how exactly it has been put into place, how it has been working in many of these countries. Increase in population density, poverty and lack of alternative income earning opportunity, and land degradation lead to reducing fallow time below for required for the natural restoration of soil nutrients. So this interacts with the use of biomass for fuel to reduce soil fertility. Attempt to respond to reduce yield by clearing more marginal lands are highly erodible, lead to further land erosion and greater land of loss of land productivity. Now, with the increase in demand for land for, say, putting up solar panels, people are looking at in terms of alternatives. But clearing of land coupled with shorter fallow period also results in deforestation, and deforestation has clear environmental problem. So, widening and reinforcing the cycle of environmental degradation and poverty. So, it affects the poor the most. That is why we, in economic theorizing, we really have to really worry about it. So, the typical effects are in the form of institutional, technological institutional changes which reinforce other negative trends of agroecology. So that happens because the land tenure problem and others. With commercialization of agriculture, the problem only it aggravates because it leads to more intensive agriculture. Now, on top of it, you have poor land tenure system. In fact, we use all the committee reports only for the right reason. Let me tell you, the first recommendation of the Mandal Committee report was implement land reforms in India. Nobody talks about it. Land reform continues to be a paper tiger. Now, look at Japan, South Korea, if you are looking at them as a role model of development, who achieved fast, rapid development in 20 years. In all these countries, land reforms were implemented before they opened up their economy. We talked about land reform in 1950, it continues to be a paper tiger because the people who govern will be the affected people. Therefore, it never gets implemented. Only two states have been good in sort of implementing land reforms, West Bengal and Karnataka, to a large extent, followed by Kerala, Tamil Nadu and few. Okay, so land tenure problem is a major issue in several parts of the country and also in several of these other countries. Okay. Now, what we are trying to therefore say is prevention is better than cure. So, prevention requires integrated approach to the problem of poverty, rural development and the environment. You cannot say I will have a poverty alleviation program, I will only look at this. It is hard to design, but more expensive and integrated rural development. Let me give you my own personal experience here when we made an attempt. It's not that simply we talk about all this, we also try to do. So a team of three of us from Jadavpur University, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore and myself took up one particular district called Chitradurg district in Karnataka. And we tried to see the implementation of NAREGA, Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Generation Program. We were trying to say is, because the act, we studied the act and then we have also published this paper subsequently. The act says clearly that no asset can be created through the NREGA. Fair enough. Basically, then I personally met John Dres, who is the brain behind this act. He is now stationed in Allahabad University. He's been there for a long time in India, French national. He was a co-author of Amartya Sen. So John said that Narayan, I don't want it to become a source of economic power for anybody in the village. We do not want only unskilled people to be employed and no asset to be created. But I said, then people are telling you, John, it's becoming digging a hole and filling up of the hole. So it makes even some of my colleagues in engineering disciplines tell me that why don't you advise the government to simply transfer the money to people's bank account rather than employing them, digging this hole and filling up this hole. NREGM also should be money transfer only. I said, no. The idea is to create employment, not money transfer. But the act says you can't create assets. So we three of us who work on in the area of environment, economics and environment, we said, why don't we create, you don't want other assets, why don't we have natural resources? So we said how to bring in ecosystem services in NREGA investments. So we took a case study of Chitradurg and said this can be done and how exactly, what kind of ecosystem services can be created using the same energy money, no expansion money, same people employed in the same area where you are spending this. We came up with an action plan. We were invited by the government. So Rural Development Ministry, which is supposed to handle this, they said you come for presentation. So we said, why don't you invite some people from Ministry of Environment and Forest also? They said, no, first we will discuss. The biggest problem in India is in the government, the right hand doesn't know what the left hand does. And they don't interact also. So, I presented here. We three of us presented. He said, this is exactly what is possible. They said, fantastic idea. Ecosystem service is not violating the act. Because this is an act passed by parliament. It's possible to do all that. So, why don't you do one thing? We are, glad to implement all this. But let us begin from Northeast India. So my other two colleagues looked at me, I said, I have no problem going to Northeast India, we can do that, etc. But ecosystem services, if you've understood what they are, is that area deprived of ecosystem services? Why don't we make a beginning from semi-arid zones, where it can have a huge environmental impact? I'm not naming any state or any district here, I'm saying semi-arid zone, where it will have immediate impact. Because, see, this flora and fauna of the states, the districts there, is much better. They have different kinds of problems. You first go and implement NREGA there. But yes, we are saying energy is very important. You can do all this. Talk to us only if you are interested in going to Northeast. So we said, okay, let us see what we can do, etc. It was just to make sure that it doesn't take off. This is exactly how, but of course, then the research paper published out of our own interest that we did the study. So how it is possible? Prevention is better than cure. Where it's possible to create these assets? In these places, otherwise they were only having, see, what is called a check dam. Rainwater harvesting and others. That's a good thing. But if you can also have ecosystem services using existing policy of the government. We are not asking for a new change in policy. You're already spending money. You're employing people. Well, let's create. So deforestation in the sense of unsustainable tree clearing interaction with land degradation is a mutually imposing cycle. About 1% of tropical forests are destroyed each year, and the rate of deforestation is also accelerating. 2/3 of the less developed countries' tropical forests are in Brazil, Indonesia, and Zaire. Okay, therefore, you can imagine which are the countries which are going to be affected by this deforestation. Causes, you know already, what are the causes of deforestation? And human and natural calamities, war, forest fires are also there, apart from industrial fuel, wood consumption, etc. It leads to three kinds of effects: soil erosion, flooding, desertification. Again, poor are the hardest hit, and since they live on the most marginal soil, and they also use on gathered wood for cooking. Now, it's very important. We talk about flood impact, extreme event, sea level rise, sudden increase in rainfall, flooding, etc. So, I'll tell you two examples of which I was involved in calculation. So, there was a deluge in Mumbai that many of you know. And insurance companies gave a lot of information to researchers, and there was a big presentation in Mumbai. I was also invited to comment on that work, where they calculated the total loss. They pegged the total loss as 5,000 crores of rupees. So, we were basically trying to find out how did we arrive at this 5,000 crores. So, then they disclosed to us, this is a team came from Paris. They said, he disclosed to us saying that this is based on the data given by insurance companies. So, I intervened by saying that, look, there are several economic activities that take place in colonies which are inundated by water for 1.5 days at least in that period. These people's livelihoods, source of livelihood or whatever small industry that they have, are not covered under the insurance. Have you imputed value for that in calculating your loss? No. What are you talking? They asked me. So we took up that study. The government of Maharashtra said, yes, we want this also to be tabled. So they said, why doesn't IIT Bombay do this estimation game? We estimated, did a survey of all the people who are living in this Kurla and other regions, various ward numbers, because BMC has data about which wards were affected, how long, what is the height of the extent of flooding, and for how many hours, etc. So we collected, so we visited, we had employed people, visited all these places, calculated by talking to them what is the economic activity and what they are doing, etc. And how long will it take for them to come back, to put the clock back? Most important. That's why we need to be sensitized. How long would it take for them to put the clock back to the level that they were the previous day before deluge? On an average, we found it to be 18 months. So, we did the calculation, and the total estimated loss of all this what is called urban informal sector in the area came to 1100 crores. So, that need to be added to the figure given by insurance company, and these people don't have any insurance to fall back upon. For many of them, it is a source of livelihood. In fact, in my earlier paper, that they follow the best style of Japanese style of management, just-in-time production. Reason being, they have neither have the capital, investment support, nor do they have space to keep the inventories. So they work on just-in-time production. And therefore, the loss is minimized. If they had worked like any other enterprise in other parts of India, not in Mumbai, which has space constraint, their losses would have been more. With this constraint, their losses 1100 crores of this all these sectors, and it is source of livelihood which they have lost. We are not talking about human loss of human life. We are only talking about loss of resources which give them income and consumption for the whole family. And in all these watts, we calculated the estimation. So that is what is definitely required. When I say example of poor or affected, this is what I mean, differential impact. Because there is no insurance coverage for these people.
As we all know, economy is the integral part of an individual to the institution level. But how much action the environment is being upgraded or audited by the economic policies laid down by the government and non-government organizations?
Yeah.
What is the action it is already upgraded and how much action is needed to be upgraded?
No, it is wherever it is mandated, we get involved in doing this valuation. Otherwise, we don't. Unless it is really required, it is only those out of research that they try to do. They don't do beyond that. Unless it is asked for. Environmental audit is very different from, it's not necessarily economic audit. It's an environmental audit. Like your chartered accountant need not know economics. They just have to check whether you are inputted all the incomes and expenditure. That's all. That is the role of chartered accountant. Environmental auditor will look at it purely from an environmental point of view. We have to look at it in terms of who is affected, etc. I cannot say Maharashtra government that 5,000 watt insurance company, you should take it as it is. You are elected by people for the people. You look at what is lost to the people. Source of livelihood is lost for them. And who is going to compensate for them? That is the kind of sensitization that is required. For no fault of theirs, sudden downpour of rain. So that is why it's important to talk about this. Of course, it also has adverse global effect in terms of what happens in tropical forests, etc. Loss of species and several others that you already familiar. I'm skipping some of this. And then you try to bring in forest management in that context only. Why it is required, how exactly forest management can be done. Okay. And what can we play through policy intervention? So all patterns of economic development lead to environmental damage. And when you try to speed up, accelerate economic development, put your leg further on the accelerator, it leads to rapid increase in environmental degradation. But all environmental effects are amenable to policy influence at the margin. I'm not saying totally, but we can sort of put this back. Now, here, so it is important that when you come up with a development policy, also keep in mind the environmental policy. The environmental policy has to combat with what is called invisible hand. We call it invisible hand because Adam Smith talked about invisible hand in development. When you leave it to the market to decide, you are led by, when you take a decision, how do you go yourself to a market and buy something? We say in markets sort of situation, you are led by an invisible hand. Somebody takes you. You don't know who he is. I'm not talking about supernatural power. We say that it is based on your own rational thinking, your understanding, knowledge that you go and take this thing. So basically, when we try to take decision for the short term, and when we work on self-interest, from the resource mining policies at the expense of the longer run, generally at least some of the poor, etc., then we'll have to see what happens. How can you be charged for benefiting everybody else? Okay, so that's where the policy should play a role. And when you formulate the policy, again they come back to this question, are there some development pathways or strategies that are environmentally better than others? Can we follow them? Or at least can we know, can we avoid some development strategy which are desiredly worse than others from an environment point of view? That if you are aware, at least we can avoid. Even if you are not able to achieve the follow-up, the environmentally benign strategies. That's exactly what, of course, there are. What is development strategy itself varies from country to country, and for the same country over a period of time, they are distinguished from each other in terms of interrelated instrumental dimension, in terms of pace of development and primary engines of growth. Should India now embark upon 10% growth rate of GDP? It's a big question, again debated. And what are the primary engines of growth? Should we depend more on service sector, more on agriculture, more on industry, and within industry which sectors? Should we depend more on construction? The US and Japan believed in automobile-led industrialization. We did not follow that. It is automobiles that led the development in those places. So it's also possible to cluster the countries in the world now in terms of different development strategies that they followed, and which have followed the same development strategy or similar development strategy. However, there could be differences in countries clustered along these dimensions because one can also, same country need not remain in this cluster for a long time. For example, we also have a closed economy for a long time. We opened up after 91. China opened up from 1978. Japan opened up from late 1960s. So is South Korea and other, Singapore, etc. So there, different countries follow or in different development strategy during different phases of the development. So there can be sectoral lines development like industrialization, balanced growth, agriculture development, let also distinguish along the lines of trade, inward or outward oriented possible. For example, development strategy adopted by Norway and Denmark are very different from what Korea and Indonesia adopted. Although at the outset it looked like both are, all these countries are dependent on agriculture and using agriculture to support industrialization. Norway and Denmark did not go for the kind of agriculture intensification that Korea and Indonesia have gone. That is why there is more sustainable. They also depend on allied sectors of agriculture like animal husbandry, dairying, which supported. And they support agriculture and this sector supported each other. We haven't gone in for many of this. So the major development strategy that you can sort of formally classify in terms of export promotion, import substitution, or balance of agriculture and industry sectoral growth, staple export strategy like African countries, sub-Saharan African countries, which had to export all the staples in order to receive the commodity that they need to consume from other countries. Or agriculture development-led industrialization like Korea. That's also various possibilities are there. So are there something which is desirably worse than this? Some evaluation is also being done. So that could be sort of presented depending upon how much time you have in your courses, etc. So that's something that I thought I'll share with you.
My question is that when we are running behind development, the same time we should think about that, how much that development is required, since we should not run like we want to become the leader. So that's why we should develop. So what happening when we are developing more and more, that the gap between rich and poor is getting wider. So that should be the first we should keep in mind, how in society, how the equitable distribution of income can be restored, then we can think about development. So this development should be, in another term, it should be environmental, friendly oriented and peace, instead of running and becoming the leader in the global scenario. So my question is actually how much development do we want?
I agree with you on the first part. You know, development should definitely, that's exactly what I'm trying to say. Development should take into account the equity as well as environmentally benign practice, etc. How much development you want is a big question that even, you know, Obama will not be able to give an answer on. Because how much development wants also varies from country to country. Because what is happening here is, can I say I don't need development when I know there are starvation deaths in Kalahandi?
Yeah.
How can you say that? So my development should be inclusive.
Then my question is that as an economist, we should have understanding actually how much, for example, I'll feel peace when I'll drive one Maruti Alto. So I don't need that Mercedes Benz. So
someone else will say, I will be peaceful when I can walk around the streets. So what do I do then?
Actually, for that reason, we should have some bar actually up to what we should develop. It's not for we want to become from developing to develop, so we want more GDP. So that to keep all these things, environment, peace, everything in the mind.
Everybody will agree with you, definitely, because there can't be any dispute about it. You need to keep them in mind. But that does not necessarily mean that we sacrifice on development also. So what I think you need to understand, what they were other countries were trying to say is, they are looking at India not in terms of development, in terms of, you know, source of technology knowledge. No, we look at the West, they look at us. So there's a transitivity that takes place. And here is an opportunity for you to play an important role. I'm not saying you have to, when you become an important player, you behave like US.
Actually, in economics, we have different like balanced growth strategies, import substitution strategy, all these strategies.
Yeah.
Why don't you have some like peace-oriented strategy in the developmental issue? So we should have some like peace-oriented and environmental strategy. So that I want to know from you.
Environment and peace can also be in conflict, let me tell you. If I go for peace-oriented, I may not be environmentally benign. Or the other way around, if I'm environmentally benign, I need not necessarily be peace-oriented. So that's a very highly debatable issue. Okay. While keeping this in mind is fine, but I don't think it's possible to formulate strategies for peace and environment benign together. Okay, that's my response.
That is the interrelationship between the economic development as well as the with its relevant to the environmental perspective.
Yeah.
So then the cost effect of the pollution, that
cost
is also
effect, yeah.
Then the cost benefit analysis of eco-friendly approach.
Okay.
And then the role of current environmental policy, that is in perspective of that economic development and also. So all together, say ask this.
No, see, the whole idea is to, you know, when we sensitize people, it's important that we, first of all, you establish the link. Why are we talking about it? Because, see, I even go to the extent of telling them from the placements. Why are you joining IIT Bombay? Why not other institutions? They give n number of reasons. But ultimately, one of the factors that you keep in mind is that you get excellent, you are hopeful of getting excellent placements. So it is eventually excellent placement in monetary terms. Apart from learning, assuming that, you know, you come here for learning and you get the best out of it, fantastic, which is required. But that's also definitely important. Now, when it comes to this, therefore, you know, you're talking about personal economy as well as economy of your country, and then link it to why it's important that we also, when we do all this, we also talk about care for the environment, on which we depend on, development itself is dependent on, which need to be established, like energy, waste management, and several others. Okay, so in the process, we try to say what kind of policy measures that are required to achieve development, which is also environmentally benign, not necessarily peaceful. Okay, so is it possible to achieve? Yes, it's possible to mix. So there, it is important that you continually evaluate, and that evaluation is done through cost-benefit analysis. That's a tool. That's exactly what I'm trying to say. Use the tools to evaluate and tell them that this, it is possible, and it is scientifically done. It is not that evaluation is done because he likes to go by auto and someone else would like to go by bicycle. There you bring in normative value judgments. You may be fine with auto because that may be consuming lesser fuel than, say, Volkswagen. But what about somebody who says, I want to use only bicycle? Definitely he is better than you. He is more environmentally benign than you, isn't it? So therefore, perceptions comes in. But it's not simply one of perception. What we want to say is that scientific principles are applied to make comparisons and then say which is among the several paths that are available to you. That means without compromising on economic development, you can also be better off environmentally. How exactly we can mix this, get the correct combination based on scientific insights is what we should tell the next generation, so that they trust you, they believe you, and then they take you seriously. Otherwise, it becomes my opinion or his opinion or your opinion.
So according to the law, second law of thermodynamics,
yes.
So entropy cannot be avoided, sir. So entropy cannot be avoided.
Correct.
So it's a spontaneous in one. So in case here, the environment concern, so we can avoid or we can tolerate or we can adjust, no, sir. Is it possible?
Well, that is for the scientists and engineers to answer. As an economist, I...
So economic point of view, I'm asking, sir.
No, we are trying to find out. I mean, let me give an example. In 2008-09, I was part of a committee which was trying to calculate whether we can go in for... International oil prices were increasing. Already reached $158 per barrel. So we're trying to calculate, can we now switch over to solar? So there was a team that came from Calcutta, made an excellent presentation to us. Grid-based solar power generation and distribution, which we have been thinking is very expensive. And they also did. So the committee was headed by Dr. R. Chidambaram, who was principal scientific advisor. So he said, Narayanan, can you do some rough estimation and told me at what price of crude oil price will this become beneficial to us so that we can convince the government? Grid-based solar power generation and distribution. You know how costly it is. Captive power plant is different. So then I did some back of the envelope calculation right there. He wanted in 5 minutes. So found out that if the international oil price hits $183 a barrel, this will become economical. Because see, obviously, to when you talk about finance ministry or other, you have to say which is better cost wise. We are not talking about environmental benefits here, simply in terms of economic costs. Assuming both of them can give you so much of power. So he said, okay, then we'll wait. So I did the calculation, only gave it to him. He said, okay, he told the others also, he has done the rough, he said, rough, very rough estimation. We'll keep that in mind. Let's look at the, you know, oil prices. Oil prices crashed in next 3 months to $48. They said, then we all decided to keep quiet. Where is 183? Where is 48? Nobody will buy this argument. So that is the sort of comparison that one has to make. So again, entropy, etc. For us, it is in terms of this cost.
Possible at any stage that solar power will become far more cheap than wood.
That's what I just answered, that on the basis of the then existing technology. I mean, it is all up to us to have technological breakthroughs so that it becomes cheaper or economical. We are all hoping that solar cells, my colleagues who are working on solar cells, will make it cheaper. So it's all, no, eventually it depends on the cost of solar cell, isn't it?
So in 1984, the Bhopal gas tragedy was there, and as a result of that, thousands of persons have died. You say, you informed us that in International Court of Law,
Court of Justice. In The Hague.
So they have fixed the compensation as per the Indians' value of life as 2 lakhs.
No, I'm not saying. I'm not saying 2 lakhs.
They have fixed on the basis of.
I did not say the amount. I don't want to be misquoted. I did not say the amount. I said they said you cannot expect a multinational company to value the life of a citizen of a country more than by its own government. I only said that.
Neetu, just I want to know what is the basis of fixing the value of life of a person by the government?
Don't know.
No. Okay.
I'll admit, I don't know. I don't think we should get into that exercise. That is not the purpose. We economists don't do that.
Okay. Thank you.
In fact, I'm objecting even to economists getting into valuing tigers and monkeys. Natural resource is fine, but that's not the way we get into economic valuation. Because we don't do even for cattle, which support your agricultural activity or other, isn't it? We don't, we should not get into it. I'm not in favor of that, but still people do engage in. We don't know the value.
Sir, you mentioned that you had been to a couple of committees, some of them are quite important.
Yeah.
And you also mentioned that, what I heard correctly, that most of them, that the recommendation or presentation that you have made finally had not been considered. In a sense,
some of them have not been implemented.
Some of them.
Yeah.
Those are equally important than the others which have been, might have been accepted.
Yeah.
We all know who decides finally.
I also don't know.
Good. But
so perhaps, because our job is to sort of inform the government and make an attempt.
Now that means.
The role of academics stops there, no?
No, the thing is that some of the economic principles and theories, which a year back to the previous government, was seemed to be very relevant. Now, those same principle, this government looks very irrelevant. And equally, a Nobel laureate economics.
Economic principles cannot change with the change of government.
So that's what. Now, the person who used to be very relevant previous government, now his theories looks irrelevant.
No, I don't think that is where the perception, for there, in their perception, it may be relevant, but it cannot lose the relevance. Unless somebody challenges it theoretically. It's not. Theory cannot change. Theory cannot become relevant for one person and irrelevant for another government.
Policy suggestion.
Policy suggestion will definitely change with change of mind, change of people, change of mind, and therefore change of approach to development.
So just a continuation of what he was asking. The International Court of Justice has said they cannot pay more than what the local government values the life of the person it rules.
That was because made as every a passing remark as an example of why one should not get into valuation.
But then, every human being is there in every country is a resource. So as part of resource, don't they have their value?
I believe so. Definitely. I think all of us are valuable to our country. And
so in terms of value, can we be converted into the currency?
That's what I'm not in favor of.
Okay.
Your insurance companies will do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Depending upon your age and my age, but and our health conditions. But I don't think that's the purpose. It doesn't serve any purpose. That's exactly what I'm trying to say in terms of resources also. Natural resources, yes, you should do because of green GDP.
Sir, in Europe, actually, there are a lot of rumors are going on that like there is going to occur a third industrial revolution. People are going to change their cars from petrol to fuel cell. Whether it is possible, sir, whether it is adaptable for India also, is there any chance?
See, one of the major, I'm not sure about what's happening there, but one major factor that we are always worried about, the cost, keeping the cost low, so that it's affordable.
Yes, sir.
So,
whether it is possible with India, sir, whether is there any
chance? Unless, we don't know the cost. Unless I know the cost, I cannot be commenting on it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
See, when I was just asking someone, Nikhil, I guess, sometime back, that 10 years ago when mobile phone was introduced, at least I thought, many of you would have also thought, that you know it's going to be beyond our reach. But today, everyone people working in tea shops also have mobile phone. So such breakthrough comes, it may become economic.
With respect to your presentation, I saw on slide GDP versus the ratio between the GDP and energy.
Energy
cost.
Per unit.
But actually, the trend goes down. It's not a favorable trend. Actually, the ratio between the GDP and the energy cost.
How much energy you are consuming per unit of GDP produced? That is going down is good, no? Which means energy saving. You are saving on energy. When you are
energy
producing
consumption.
More,
okay, okay. I thought it's energy consumption. Okay. Sir, one more thing. Yeah. It's something general.
Yeah.
It's the cost of petrol. Why do we have always on a higher side when compared to the neighboring countries? It is something
neighboring countries. It's gone down in India also now.
No. Pakistan, they are saying 24 rupees. Bengal, West Bengal, they are saying 22 rupees.
Okay. No, I can tell you, it's purely economic reason. You know, sometimes we would like to fix price for certain commodities and services to discourage you from consumption also.
Then that should be the case for all. Even for the car, everything should be.
No, if you do that, cost of transportation goes up, then you and I will spend them, we have to be given more transport allowance. So, government's non-plan expenditure will go up.
Okay.
So, it can't be unreasonably high.
This is something related to the green GDP, sir. One among the recommendations in the sustainable development practice, the quality of the product, its durability is to be considered.
Quality of product, durability. Okay.
It should be. Better the quality. So it will be better for the sustainable development. The cost or the fact is included in the green GDP.
Green GDP doesn't really talk about that. In fact, since you asked, I'm just coming to that. Let me answer.
I don't know whether
through.
You may have the question answer for that.
I'm just, okay. I just quickly tell you how the green GDP is done. If you're finished, I'll just go ahead.
I had interacted one of the IIT in project associate yesterday. I had a dinner with them yesterday night. Even I am unknown to them. There was a very excellent work is going in IIT. Energy Department of Energy. They have a tie-up. They have invented solar lamps, and they have tie-up with the one of the industries at Charlapalli, Hyderabad. And they are been manufacturing the electrical lamps. These lamps have been distributing on sale across the India. Today, the figure is 8 lakhs lamps have been distributed to the students.
Children.
I know, I'm in the advisory board of that. I know, that's what I want to ask the question here. And out of the 10 lakhs, 8 lakhs have been already being distributed.
Yeah.
The goal is to just supply these, distribute these lamps to every boy, school boy, length and breadth of the India, they want to distribute it.
Boy or girl?
Yeah. Now, I want to ask one thing. Have you got doing any kind of the statistical research? How much of this economic saving you would have on this actually replacing the non-renewable energy by giving the solar lamps, replacing the conventional this thing? Are you doing any kind of the research work on the economic statistical point of view? You have any research trends on this and research? I want to ask this.
Yes, thank you.
And another thing is, I want to just convey to the organizers, sorry, because the session will be open afterwards, in the throughout the thread of this, you know, delivering the lecturers, in between, why can't you invite such a research associates who have been developing a small sample model so that in between the actually the lecturers, the research associate, project associate will come, make a display, talk to the people, interact the people, so that the people will go to the institution, not only the giving a text knowledge, as well as what real research of the work is going on, so that more and more, you know, things could be improved in a better way. So that's my intention.
Okay.
I want to ask you, at the point of the context you are delivering,
yeah,
the economics about actually the part of the environment on the you know, these solar lamps, what you got any statistic, please explain me in it.
Yeah, sure. Well, I can have a detailed discussion with you on that. Yes, there is another colleague in the name of Narayanan, Dr. N.C. Narayanan. I am also in the advisory board of that project, where we are looking at socio-economic impact of solar table lamps distributed to children studying in school, mostly in villages, remote areas. We are studying the socio-economic impact, therefore the environmental impact also. Already undertaken. We are already doing the study. This is a major initiative of IIT Bombay, which I think is a very, very, you know, satisfying thing for us. Yes. Thanks for asking. We are already doing that study. Results are not ready for us to disclose, but the study is already on that. Okay. Now, coming to green GDP estimation, quickly let me tell you, how is the green GDP different from conventional GDP? First of all, you have to understand how the conventional GDP is estimated. Does anyone know here who estimates GDP for our country? Do you know who is responsible to estimate gross domestic product for India? Central, let us be answered by non-economists, yeah? You have been trained as an economist. Okay, Central Statistical Organization, Government of India, under the Ministry of Statistics. Okay, now, they have different methods. Different countries use different methods. By and large, we have value method, that is value-added approach, expenditure or the income approach. Okay, now, since I assume that you know what is GDP and therefore NDP, NDP is GDP minus gross domestic product, net domestic product. Net domestic product is gross domestic product minus the depreciation of man-made capital, that is wear and tear of machinery and others that we use. So the depreciation allowance, if you deduct from GDP, you get NDP, net domestic product. That's what we do. And NDP at market price gives you national income, and you divide by population, you get per capita income. Okay. Now, for national income, sometimes we also add here, apart from NDP, we also add net factor income from abroad, that is Indian working abroad, sending money to the families here, minus foreigners working in India, sending money to their families there. That becomes the GNP or national income, etc. Now, green GDP was included basically to check how sustainable your development process is going to be. So, green GDP is defined as NDP minus IEC, imputed environmental costs, where IEC is defined as the degradation and depletion of the natural assets. Now, this obviously means it has to be a number. It has to be evaluated and examined, etc. So, IEC is comprised of economic costs induced by natural resource depletion, destruction of the ecosystem, degradation of natural assets, as well as air and water pollution. Now, there are several methods and research continues on this of System of Environmental and Economic Accounting, SEEA. Is being done, and now like the GDP, you know, conventional method that is being adopted by various countries, there are international forums where it is being discussed so that everybody adopts similar measure so that your GDP becomes, or green GDP becomes, comparable. The dispute that our friend asked earlier, China, etc., because there is a lot of discussion about what should go on in that accounting. Similar debate took place in the case of GDP estimation also long, long ago. But now that's sort of agreed upon. Green GDP, the discussion is not for the last 20 years. So, several rounds of discussion, now the sort of basic, what I am going to present to you is one of the fundamental methods that is used to estimate this. Of course, a lot of refinements and developments have come about in this. Maybe we can take it up before June so that we can even calculate and show them how exactly it is being done, etc. Okay. Now, let me give one example because of the paucity of time. Calculate the rate of depletion and for resource and for produced natural assets such as forest, the cost of depletion is set equal to reproduction cost of the net reduction of resource. So simple formula that we look up, we make a distinction between renewable and non-renewable. Okay, now the concept of user cost. How exactly user cost is calculated? So here we assume, we look at two scenarios. One, as if the resource is available infinitely, the point that Nikhil was pointing to me, that you economists assume the resource is available infinitely, and alternatively, as if the resource is available only finite period. We calculate the user cost under both the scenarios and then look at what happens here. Is the formula is very simple, it is what it is, which is taken into account to user cost of all the resources that are used in your production process. And this is basically finally reduced into, so we are assuming that IRE should be equal to IR, this thing, into total revenue from both the process should be equal, so that you can deduct it from the GDP in terms of only the resource. So finally, this is the formula that by substitution we can get this. User cost should be of a particular resource is into 1 plus R to the power minus N. Okay. The other components that we look at, like some of it we actually don't value at all. So I say that is important that we value forest, cultivation, non-economic assets. Say for example, water and air, we don't impute value. So if it is polluted, how do you estimate the value? How do you deduct it from what is the cost of pollution? So abatement cost is what we, marginal abatement cost is what taken as a estimation of, for the calculation of input environmental cost here. Okay, so basically we use marginal abatement cost. Same for water, air and water both we use the marginal abatement cost. Now you must note that we are not indulging in damage estimation, because there are two different approaches to social cost of environmental degradation. Okay. Now, for example, in the case of air and water pollution, the input environmental cost evaluates the social cost in terms of expenditure to prevent pollution emission. On the other hand, the environmental damage method measures them on the basis of actual losses of production, and the medical expenses or social cost of the society has to bear. Sometimes people value, you know, value lost when there's a strike or lockout, or today people have declared themselves sick for watching match, can impute loss to the economy because so many people are not reported to work. Okay. Now, so do we include social losses? Obviously, it's not possible. So therefore, this also has limitation only in terms of the purpose for which it need to be calculated, etc. So we are aware that environmental degradation can manifest in terms of rising concentration of pollution, resource depletion, etc. Okay, what I wanted to definitely tell you is environmental degradation can be characterized in five ways: sources, receptors, intermediates, environmental process, linking sources to, for example, I give an example in each of these, some dwellers are basically receptors, increase in economic activity like automobile, chemical, and intermediate environmental process, linking sources to receptors. And agents, social agents to environmental degradation, feedback or responsible socialization, social determinants of economic activity like population, livestock growth, etc. But here you must, in economics, when it comes to any such calculation of GDP or the thing in macroeconomic sense, the first and foremost we tell students to distinguish between stocks and flows. Are you talking about stocks or are you talking about flows? That distinction is extremely important. Stocks are basically investments, goods and others which are already there. Flows are, for IIT Bombay stocks, all the, you know, classrooms and other facilities that are there. Flows are students who come and go. So we keep that, you know, sort of that stock and flow distinction very important. So here we talk about pressure indicator, impact indicator, sustainability indicator, etc., where pressure indicators are by and large flow variables, because pressure can change and it can also cross border. And impact indicator also reflect the impact of pressure on the receptor. Okay. Now, but sustainability indicator, the moment you bring in, normative valuation comes in. While the other two can be simply based on. So, this is exactly what, say, that's why sometimes people call economics as a dismal science. Because there's a normative valuation that comes in. Then your perception comes in. So, the picture, the difference between current and reference value, but then your values, your personal value judgments come in. That is exactly what we need to avoid. Otherwise, it becomes bias in favor of the person who is looking at it, etc. Okay, so we have identified. So what we also will be sharing is, how is it possible? Is sustainable development only a myth, or is it possible to operationalize? Four steps that we're going to be talking about, how to implement sustainable development. Okay? So I think I have a few more other slides, but I think in the interest of time, I'll stop here. So basically what I wanted to say is, what we intend to do is introduce this, you know, interaction between economy and the environment. We bring in what kind of development approach pathways are better, and which are environmentally differently disastrous, concept and measurement of green GDP, and formulating policy to achieve sustainable development. I think well, that's exactly what we cover in this. Are there any points you want to talk? Maybe one quick question.
What could be fit in the social impact assessment?
Social impact assessment is itself is a tool that we'll have to, we need time to explain.
Environmental ethics is it is concerned to human part in it.
Correct.
In the same manner, how the environmental economies can be connected
here it to is
the human part.
Entire economic activities for you and me, human only.
Human
economic activities.
How the decision is being taken on based on the human
decision,
instead of going for any mathematical
decision is taken by you and me for ourselves. If we don't have stomach to worry about, there will not be many economic problems, isn't it? So it is for us taken by ourselves.
Hello.
That's what the economics is all about.
So in last slide, sir, you shown some equations to calculate the damage to the environment. Okay, some equations are there.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Is it possible that two different persons calculate out the damage to the environment would be different?
Discuss and arrive at a consensus on the methodology internationally.
But same methodology is adopted then also, is it possible to have different?
No, then it should give the same result. That's why you don't do social valuation.
Okay.
Social valuation will differ because life is valued differently in America and India.
Okay.
For the same individual.
So does whether the green GDP depends on the natural impact?
Natural impact? Yeah, definitely.
Natural calamity.
Yes. Yes.